All right. Hello. Welcome, everyone, to today's webinar, which is brought to you by Oxford Instruments in partnership with Azo Materials and is titled, What is Benchtop NMR for? What is Benchtop NMR for and why use it? Big thank you to everyone at Oxford Instruments for putting on today's event and to you in the audience for joining us from across the world. My name is Daniel Azel from AZOM, and I'm delighted to be moderating for you all today. I'd first like to introduce today's three fantastic speakers, and then I'll explain a little bit about how the format for today's webinar will work. So firstly, we're delighted to be joined by Dr. Raghuraj Hoshing. Raj is an application scientist at Oxford Instruments based out of Pleasanton, California. He's completed his PhD in organic chemistry from Brown University, where he worked on synthesis and NMR characterization of supramolecular dyes. We're also thrilled to welcome Wendy Nason. Wendy is also an application scientist. She is based out of Concord, Massachusetts. She is completing her PhD in materials chemistry, where she worked on synthesis and characterization of mixed metal Dion Jacobson perovskites. And finally, joining Wendy and Raj is Dr. Shieda Rajabi. Shieda is an application scientist based out of Germany. She got her PhD in organic chemistry from the Georg August University, where she worked on the synthesis and characterization of molecular ruthenium-based complexes and their application as water oxidation catalysts. A big welcome to all three of you. Thank you for taking the time to share your expertise with the audience today. In just a moment, Raj will get us started before handing things over to Wendy, and then Shieda will finish the presentation up before we move into the audience Q&A. So if you have any questions at any stage during the webinar today, just write them in the Q&A box and we will answer as many as possible in the Q&A session following the presentations. A quick note that if you are watching this back on demand, then you'll get a reply to your question via email. Finally, before we get started, we are, of course, recording today's webinar. We'll share the link with you via email within the next few days. So please do share that email with anyone else you feel would benefit from watching today's content. And you can, of course, watch back on demand anything that you missed today. Right, Raj, let's get you unmuted. You should be coming through now. And if you want to take it away whenever you're ready.
Awesome. Thank you for that great introduction, Danny. So again, welcome to this webinar on introduction to benchtop NMR. As Danny said, my name is Raj, and this webinar is brought to you today by Oxford Instruments. So all three of us are application scientists with Oxford Instruments. So a little bit about us as a company. We were founded in the late 50s, and we've been in the magnetic resonance space since then, since the very beginning, actually. Our very first product was the world's first superconducting magnet, and this was then utilized in the very first commercial MRI machine. So we've been in the magnetic resonance space for a long, long time. We've since then expanded quite a bit, both geographically and in terms of our scientific capabilities. So currently, we developed various technologies, including detectors for scanning electron microscopies, as well as AFM instruments and Raman microscopy instruments and various other technologies. But of course, today we're here to talk about our magnetic resonance capabilities, as well as what these products can do for you. So as I was saying, we have a worldwide presence now. I'm based here in the San Francisco Bay Area in Pleasanton, California. Wendy is based in the Boston, Massachusetts area, whereas Shieda is in Germany. And we have various other regional hubs and head offices all around the world. In terms of our magnetic resonance capabilities, we have a NMR spectroscopy instrument, the X-Pulse shown here. We also have a time domain NMR instrument, the MQC. If you don't know what these things can do or much about these techniques, well, that's what we're here to discuss today. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about some NMR theory, as well as what sort of data you can expect to see from NMR spectroscopy and TD NMR techniques and how you can interpret these pieces of data. And then I'll hand over to my colleagues, Shieda and Wendy, who are going to be talking about some practical applications of these techniques. So let's get started here with some NMR theory first. All right, so something familiar, I'm sure we all know that a lot of the universe is composed of what we call matter. And matter is made out of molecules, which are made out of atoms. And atoms contain electrons, as well as a nucleus, which is made up of protons and neutrons, right? So protons and neutrons can have a property known as spin, which they can impart onto the nucleus, depending on how many protons and neutrons are present in the nucleus. So what does this spin do exactly? Well, it imparts something like a bar magnet property onto the nucleus. So in your sample, the various spins associated with the various nuclei in your sample are generally randomly oriented, right? However, if you put your sample in a strong magnetic field, the various spins either align themselves with this magnetic field or they align themselves against the magnetic field, right? So those spins that align themselves with the magnetic field are in a lower energy state, whereas those spins that align themselves against the magnetic field are in a higher energy state, not magnetic field, external magnetic field. So what you can do is use a radio frequency pulse, which is essentially sort of a beam of energy, to excite some of these lower energy spins such that you rotate the overall magnetic moment by, say, 90 degrees. Now, the torque exerted by the external magnetic field means that this overall magnetic moment precesses, undergoes this sort of motion here. And what that does is it induces an electrical current in a coil surrounding the sample, right? And this electrical current is then plotted and plotted against time. And this plot is known as the free induction decay. So you can use a magnetic or you can use a mathematical process known as Fourier transformation to convert this data into the frequency domain. And the spectrum that you obtain by doing this is known as an NMR spectrum. And this is unique for any given molecule. So you can use NMR to identify the presence of whichever molecule in your sample. Our instrument, the X-Pulse, is the instrument that does this technique. Now, sometimes you can also actually just use the time domain data to get a lot of information about your sample. And this technique is known as time domain NMR, or TD NMR. And our instrument, the MQC, performs this technique, all right? So let's take a look at what some data from NMR spectroscopy actually looks like and what kind of information you can get from it. What does this data actually tell you? So here we're going to use the example of a proton 1D NMR, which is sort of considered the standard bread and butter technique for any, say, organic chemist, and the one that is most commonly used, right? So we're going to use the example of a 1D NMR of ethyl crotonate to see what kind of data you can see from a proton NMR, right? So this is what a simple 1D proton NMR of ethyl crotonate looks like. So you get this by, as I was saying on a previous slide, you rotate the overall magnetic moment by 90 degrees and then collect the free induction decay. You wait between scans. This is known as the relaxation delay for the magnetic moment to recover, and then repeat until you get a good enough signal. All right, so let's see what you can actually learn from this data once you collect it. So the first piece of information that you want to see is where the peaks fall on the x-axis, right? So this is known as the chemical shift. This tells you something about the chemical environment of the protons that the signals are coming from, right? So for example, in our current spectra that we were just looking at, we can say that this particular molecule probably contains alkanes, an ester proton, and alkene protons based on where the chemical shifts lie for these various peaks, right? So the first piece of information that we can get is what kind of functional groups are present in your molecule. So over here, as we just said, we have alkanes, ester protons, and alkene protons, and we can see that from our chemical structure. So essentially, this tells you something about the bond connectivity and the bond angles, all right? So let's take a look at an example here from our plot. So you can see that these peaks over here are split into three different peaks, essentially. It's not just one peak, right? So it's a set of what looks like three peaks. So this is known as a triplet. So what we have is known as the n plus one rule. So essentially, if a peak is split into n plus one peaks, it has n protons as its neighbors. Okay, so the fact that we see a triplet, that is three peaks, that means n plus one equals three. So this particular set of protons has two neighbors, right? So two proton neighbors. Let's take a look at another example here. We can see that this is a quartet, or that this, the fact that this peak is split into four different peaks, right? So n plus one is four. That means this particular set of protons has three proton neighbors. All right, so let's take a look at the molecule here and see how that corresponds. So we said that the methyl group should have two proton neighbors, and it does, right? So it has two neighboring protons. Whereas the ester protons, which is split into four peaks, has three proton neighbors. And we can see that over here, right? So it has three neighboring protons, and that's why it's split into four different peaks. All right. Another sort of piece of information that lies in this J coupling values is you can tell which two set of peaks are coupled to each other, right? So the distance between these peaks can be measured in Hertz, and they should be equivalent for the two sets of peaks that are coupled to each other. So this quartet, the distance between each of these peaks is 7.2 Hertz, and this triplet over here, which you can see the blown up view, the distance between these peaks is also 7.2 Hertz. That means this set of protons and this set of protons are coupled to each other, that they're neighboring protons. So you can figure out information about bond connectivity by looking at these J coupling values, right? So another piece of information that you can get from these J coupling values is information on bond angles, right? So two protons that are cis to each other have a coupling constant of typically about 10 Hertz, whereas two protons that are trans to each other have a J coupling value of about 16 Hertz. So let's take a look at our example here. So we can see that these two set of peaks have a J coupling value of about 15.5 Hertz, which is typical of trans protons. So we can say that our ethyl crotonate is in, we have the trans stereoisomer over here. So just to conclude, using all of these pieces of information, you can assign the various peaks to the various protons in your molecule. And we were able to do this by first taking a look at the chemical shift, which is essentially where the peaks lie on the x-axis, the integration, which tells you about how many protons does each peak correspond to, and finally, the J coupling values, which tell you something about the bond connectivity and the bond angles, right? So that's this is a great example and shows you can learn a lot about the structure of your molecule just by looking at a simple 1D proton NMR. All right, so now let's take a look at what some time domain NMR data looks like and what that can tell you. All right, so as I was saying earlier, in time domain NMR, you simply collect the NMR signal and plot it against time. This is really useful when you're analyzing a sample which has a mix of different phases. And why is that? Well, solids tend to lose their NMR signal or magnetization pretty quickly. So the NMR signal decays pretty quickly for solids, whereas for liquids, the NMR signal decays more slowly. Now, this is really useful in many scenarios. So for example, imagine you have a sample which contains a mixture of solids and liquids, right? So first you can measure the total signal coming from your sample. And then eventually as the signal decays, all of the signal is actually just coming from the liquid now because the liquid signal decays more slowly. So in the later part of your time period of collecting the signal, you're only collecting the liquid signal. Now we use a sort of a slightly fancy technique, and I won't go too deep into this, known as Hahn echo, to get the true liquid signal since you've actually lost some of the signal as you went along. So you can refocus the signal and figure out how much of the signal is coming just from the liquid. Now you know how much of the signal, how much total signal you have, and how much of the signal is coming from just the liquid. So you can use a calibration curve to figure out exactly how much of the liquid component you have and then how much of the solid component you have and so on and so forth. So that's what time domain NMR data looks like. So now I'm going to hand over the presentation to my colleague, Wendy, who's going to talk about some practical applications of NMR spectroscopy.
Awesome. Thank you so much. So let's take a look at NMR spectroscopy applications. Traditionally, NMR spectroscopy experiments are conducted at high fields. These high field instruments are operated by large superconducting magnets that require dedicated space, personnel, and specialized training, also the use of expensive cryogens. Benchtop NMR spectroscopy enables scientists to conduct the same experiments at lower fields. Our benchtop NMR spectroscoper, the X-Pulse, is operated by a permanent magnet at 60 degrees Celsius and functions at room temperature. The X-Pulse eliminates the need for cryogens, possesses minimal stray fields, and is easily integrated into laboratories. The X-Pulse is the only benchtop spectrometer on the market capable of observing 33 different nuclei. NMR spectra are collected for the nuclei labeled in dark blue. The nuclei depicted in dark orange are within the window of detection. And the nuclei in gray are out of the window of detection. Let's discuss some NMR applications in the pharmaceutical space. High field benchtop and benchtop NMR spectrometers are routinely used to determine molecular structure. In the first section of the webinar, Raj demonstrated the interpretation process for determining the structure of a typical small organic molecule. NMR spectroscopy is by nature quantitative. The quantitative nature is based on the direct relationship between the observed signal response and the number of nuclei generating the signal. Quantitative NMR measurements provide information on the amount of substance in the sample in relation to other components, whether a mixture of components in the sample or reference material for calibration. Here we have a neat sample of hexafluorobenzene, a solvent you may be familiar with. We can measure fluorine NMR in this neat sample without the use of deuterated solvent on the X-Pulse. Typically, deuterated solvents are needed in NMR spectroscopy for lock-in purposes. The X-Pulse uses a lock signal that is external to the sample. If we take a look at the fluorine spectrum, it is clear that we have a single peak. But if we take a closer look at the baseline, we can identify contamination of bromotrifluorobenzene isomer. The spectra is only one scan. It shows the high resolution capability of the X-Pulse. Absolute QNMR can also be done with an external calibrant, a separate NMR tube, glass capillary, or standard requiring two measurements on the as shown on the right. QNMR can be done through absolute quantitation using an internal standard to produce a single NMR spectrum. Here we demonstrate the absolute quantitation of lansoprazole, active ingredient of common acid reducer, with an internal standard for 4-difluorobenzophenone. This produces a single NMR peak, and this spectrum was acquired in 5 minutes. Reaction monitoring is one of the many applications of qNMR, where any comparison of the amount of starting material, intermediates, products, and impurities required relative qNMR. NMR spectrometers are used to monitor reactions in a variety of ways, such as by preparing a single reaction in an NMR tube, taking aliquots for a reaction mixture, or flowing the reaction directly from the reaction vessel into the spectrometer. While preparing a reaction in an NMR tube can give insight into reaction mechanism, it is not necessarily representative of what is occurring inside the reaction vessel. For example, reaction vessels may have continuous mixing. Continuous reaction monitoring, such as flow NMR, can provide greater understanding of the reaction as it occurs in the vessel. If we look at the illustrative setup, using a pump, the reaction mixture can flow directly from the reaction vessel through a flow cell in the X-pulse when spectra are measured and the reaction goes back to the vessel for continuous monitoring. The benefit of benchtop NMR for this purpose is a small footprint, flexibility, and placement in the laboratory. This can be achieved by continuously analyzing wherever and whatever the reaction vessel is. Here we have a reaction monitoring example. We had to anonymize the data, but you can clearly see several key points. We are monitoring the aldehyde proton from the starting material. The proton signal indicates when the reaction mixture has reached equilibrium. This allows for rapid process optimization and the full NMR spectrum. We can see the initial buildup of the hemiacetal forming an equilibrium with the starting aldehyde. We can also see the slower formation of final product corresponding to the green signal at 8.15 ppm. Being able to track these different components allows us for finer process control and optimization. For this reaction, they are investigating several reaction conditions to change the ratios. These investigations may also elucidate further information about mechanism formations of final products which are currently unknown. Let's take a look at food allotropy. Coffee is a popular beverage, and there are two species cultivated, Arabica and Robusta. Out of the two species, Arabica is considered to produce the superior quality coffee. Kate Kemsley's group at the Quantum Institute in Norwich, his partnership in Oxford Instrument, used the X-pulse to differentiate between Arabica and Robusta. On the left, you can see a 1D spectra of the coffee beans extracted at 60 megahertz in red and 600 in blue. The 600 spectra is obviously much better resolved, but you can clearly pick out some of the peaks. All of the information at 600 megahertz is present at 60. The challenge is to extract the important information. On the right, you can see several of the key peaks identified. We have 16 methyl castanol in black, and the 16 OMC peak shows a strong signal at 3.16 ppm. This is a region where Robusta shows up. The initial idea is to use this 16 OMC marker as a simple yes and no test. Here we have a much larger comparison of those two different coffee varieties. As you can see, the 16 OMC peak is clearly distinguishable as 60 megahertz. Here we have the 3.16 ppm marker. And as we can see, with the 20 Robusta peaks, we do have small amounts of Robusta mixture in the Arabica and Robusta. And we can see the intensity is decreasing as the number of beans are decreasing as well. Mixtures of Arabica and Robusta were extracted, and the signal at 2.6 ppm was measured. As you can see on the left, the peak does get larger with increasing Robusta content. On the right, the graph shows a linear response with an R-squared of 99% from 0 to 16%. One final look at benchtop NMR spectrometer applications is battery electrolytes. The X-balls can be used to measure commercial electrolytes. Here we have an example of lithium hexafluorophosphate and ethyl carbonate and dimethyl ethyl carbonate. The 1D spectra allows us to quickly determine solvent composition. The lithium hexafluorosulfate salt can also be monitored. We can also detect product compositions. Using 19 fluorine spectra, within a few minutes, we can see clear information on the PF6 anion species. We can detect possible decomposition products, which gives us insight on the electrolyte performance. We can also design efficient electrolytes by testing these samples on the X-ball spectrometer. This allows us to gain insight on diffusion constant, cation transference, and number of ionic conductivity. Understanding the mobility of the ion in the electrolyte solution, the rate of diffusion of all components, and how efficiently the ion is diffusing can lead to the development of exceptional electrolytes. Using the pulsatile gradient experiment, gradient pulses are steadily increased during the acquisition. The diffusion coefficient can be calculated using the Steckel-Tanner equation, and the ionic conductivity and cation transference values can be deduced. Here we have an example of lithium hexafluorophosphate and ethylene carbonate and dimethyl carbonate. And this is acquired at 39.9 degrees C. Using pulse field gradient experiments, we can determine the diffusion constant of all components present in the electrolyte and further deduce the ionic conductivity and the transference capacity of the cation. We can also measure diffusion with varied temperature. We have the largest variable temperature capability on the market. Here, lithium is measured at temperatures ranging from 2.5 to 55.5 degrees Celsius, and we observe a decrease in diffusion coefficients as the temperature increases. I will now turn over to Shieda, who discuss the time domain NMR.
So, hi everyone. So, first of all, thanks to Danny, Wendy, and Roy. And now we can work together through the time domain NMR section. This part is intended to familiarize you with several concepts as what time domain NMR is, what it can measure, and where it can be applied. So as my colleagues have already introduced you, we have two types of benchtop NMR instrumentation at Oxford Instruments, as high field called X-pulse with 60 megahertz. That my colleague Wendy have already showed you, and also low resolution TD-NMR, which uses a lower magnetic field strength and also homogeneity to accommodate larger sample sizes. Therefore, using this technique, getting chemical information or a spectra is not possible. So worth to mention that these two instruments are complementary, and based on the application, each technique can be favored. So now why should we use TD-NMR rather than time domain NMR spectroscopy? So there are several reasons. First of all, TD-NMR is very simple and a rapid analysis can be done in a few minutes or in a few seconds. It requires minimal sample preparation and everyone without having a scientific background can run the measurement. From the safety point of view, it doesn't require any hazardous solvent and chemicals. It's non-destructive technique, so means you can measure your sample several times, and also you can measure your sample on different instruments. And above all, TD-NMR provide outstanding accuracy and repeatability. So now I'm going to talk briefly about the NMR hardware and as well as the typical sample preparation. So each TD-NMR can accommodate a sample holder or cold probe inside the magnet. So the size of the probe can vary based on the application. However, the maximum is dependent on the magnetic field strength, which limits the space between the poles. MQC plus 23 with higher operating frequency is well used for smaller sample sizes to provide the best sensitivity or to measure solids and fluorine-containing materials. In another side, MQC plus 5, it can be suitable for inhomogeneous samples like agriculture products and byproducts such as oil seeds and olives. In this method, a larger sample size is required to provide the best reproducibility. So the time domain NMR procedure. So the measurement by itself, it's very straightforward. For most application, the sample can be measured without any alteration, although some need to be dried beforehand if the water signal interferes with the NMR signal, like in foods and agriculture products with higher water content as olives or mesocarps. Then samples need to be weighed if it's required, if it's mentioned in the application. Then samples are conditioned at either room temperature, where rapid results are required, or if samples are too large to be conditioned in a short time. 40 degrees, at which the magnet probe is normally stabilized to get the best repeatability, or other temperatures as specified according to the application, in order to discriminate the analytes of the interest. At the end, the sample can be measured typically less than a minute, except for very low concentrations or samples containing fluorine, which may take even a bit longer, but up to a minute. So now I'm going to talk about the applications and industries where time domain NMR is mainly used. So for decades, TD-NMR has been used as a solvent-free method to measure oil and fat in food because the result was independent of the granularity, color, or other constituents. Besides its primary application, TD-NMR can also be used to set up and monitor production lines for several industries like snack foods, like nuts, chocolate, dry pet food, and dairy products like milk powder, infant, and nutritional formula. So it's also possible to measure oil and fat content in wet foods after drying, like in meat, in fish, or related products. There is a Nordic Committee on Food Analysis Measurement for a measurement of fish, fish meal, or fish feed, where the TD-NMR is calibrated using a cod liver oil sample. Furthermore, it's also possible to measure the fat content in dairy products and also processed food like margarine, butter, cream, and similar products. So here, for example, you can see in this graph, which is a calibration using dairy products, the product that was obtained from the supermarket. So here, as you can see, the calibration is linear over a wide range of fat, wet weight from 0 to 80%. Although the calibration is very good here with a standard deviation of 0.57, or even better, 0.29 after removal of the double cream, but still the accuracy of this measurement can be improved if the actual sample were measured by a reference method rather than from the product labels which obtained from the supermarkets. Besides dairy products, it's also possible to measure solid fat content in edible oil and the fat used in margarine or spreads, as well as the bakery and confectionery industries. Maybe it's worth to mention that by confectionery, I mean chocolate, which is made using cocoa butter, a fat extracted from the cocoa butter, a fat extracted from the cocoa beans. So as you have already seen this diagram earlier, here we can observe the fast and slow decaying components representing solid and liquid fat respectively. So the true solid content cannot be determined at the beginning of the graph due to the dead time. And so instead, the signal loss between the 90 degree pulse and the signal being recorded must be determined or calibrated using real samples with known concentration. So once the instrument has been calibrated, it's very easy to collect data on samples that have been equipped at different temperatures. So there are some here, you can see some example of the melting profiles, that is the solid fat content of edible oil and fats conditioned at different temperature from 10 to 40 degrees. Celsius. So the melting profile usually relates to their sensory and physical properties, which is very important for the eventual end use. As you can see here, the shortenings, which shown as color red and also green, tend to have higher solid fat content across the temperature range to ensure that the baked goods are solid enough but not greasy at lower temperature, to ensure that until they reach the mouth. Whereas the margarine has a lower solid fat content to ensure that it's soft and spreadable after removing it after removal from the fridge. So as well as food, TDNMR can measure oil and water content in a variety of agriculture products and byproducts. The advantages over other methods are that TDNMR let us to measure a wide variety of volumes. Also, the calibration is independent of the particle size, the color, and origin of the sample. Usually, a large volume of commonly oil seeds can be measured to calculate crop value by an ISO standard method. Measurement of small volumes are usually of interest of researchers who are seeking to optimize the oil content and other properties of the seeds. It's also possible to measure the oil seed residue after crushing to ensure most of the oil has been completely extracted. Similarly, oil content can be measured in olive paste and palm mesocarps after drying, as you can see in the picture. The applications that I've introduced so far measure the relatively high concentration of oil and fat. However, TDNMR is very sensitive to lower concentration, typically less than 1% of oil or lubricants added to the fibers to reduce friction during processing, as well as to enhance their physical properties. And that can be also used to measure other liquids applied to the nonwovens and soft solids such as latex or rubber, which usually is applied to improve the bonding feature of fibers. Measurement of very low low quantities after oil removal is critical for certain applications like adherence of a mosquito repellent chemical or other high-performance coating. Furthermore, we can measure fluorinated coating, which are often applied to the carpets or to the textile for the fire retardant and water resistant properties. Using this method, we can also measure the reduction of the coating after several time washing. So all the applications that I've discussed so far have involved simple one or two pulse acquisition. However, in fact, there are a whole array of pulse sequences which may be used to analyze multiple components of a sample. The one which is commonly used is called T2 relaxometry, using the CPMG pulse sequence, which is a train of pulses, train of pulses to produce echoes to determine the exponential T2 relaxation of the material being analyzed. This technique has been widely used in food science. So to summarize our presentation, today we try to show you about our system, our instruments. So our benchtop NMR is a compact cryogen-free instrument that is very easy to integrate in any laboratory space. It's safe and is very user-friendly. Our X-pulse spectrometer, with unique broadband multi-nuclei selection, allows identifying both qualitative and quantitative information and monitoring reaction dynamics. So example of qualitative applications include structure elucidation and molecular identification. Example of quantitative applications include determination of sample concentrations and quantifying the composition of samples. MQC Plus Analyzer enables a rapid, accurate, and simple measurement of oil, water, fluorine, and fat content to provide with QA, QC solution for food, agriculture, textile, polymers, chemical, pharmaceutical, and other industries. So thank you for listening to us and hope you found our webinar informative. You can also check to get more information. You can check our website at nmr.oxins.com. You can also follow our LinkedIn and you can also join us for upcoming webinars. Thank you.
All right, just whilst everyone's getting set up, if you do have a question for any of the speakers today, just jot those down in the right-hand side of your screen, and we'll get to as many of those as we can in the next 10 minutes or so. Wendy, I see you're back at your original station, so I'll start with you. We've had a question asking if a user breaks a glass tube in the instrument, is it a service call or will they need to send the instrumentation back?
Great question. So with our instrument, it is a user removable probe. Using finger tight screws, one is able to remove the probe, clean out the probe itself with some isopropyl alcohol and a tube cleaner. So no service call and does not take very long.
Awesome. Great. So no service. Well, that's always good news. Shieda, I'll bring you back in. Thank you. I know you've just finished up and you've run around your office to change desks. So hopefully you're good to go here. This question's asking, is it possible to measure both hydrogen and fluorine on the same instrument?
Yes, it's possible because we have this removable probe, as Wendy mentioned. So we can switch between different probes based on the application. Even if you don't need any special tool, you just need to remove the probe and just put the fluorine one.
Perfect. And then another question for you, Shieda, is asking, what can T2 relaxometry be used for?
So there are plenty of applications for T2 relaxometry. One of them that I mentioned is like application in food industries, because usually like food components like meats or dairy can involve of several multi-component, like there are several components in the same sample. So relaxometry can help us to analyze all these components. Also, we can investigate the pore size distribution, like in concrete, in rock, or in cement, using relaxometry. Another application is a kind of a relaxometry on polymer, that we can measure the TD NMR like on polymers at different temperature to get some information about the structure of the polymer sample. So food industry is only one of the applications that I've mentioned today, but there are plenty of them for relaxometry.
Perfect. And then Wendy, if I come back to you, this question is asking about the experiments. They're saying, are experiments fixed or is there flexibility in the software? One second, Wendy, just unmute you a second. Oh. We got you.
Thank you. So our software is very modular, so it's perfect for both users or an NMR expert. We do have two views, where if this is a technician using the instrument for quick 1D experiments, they can be set up for this, and they just need to insert their sample and begin their acquisition. But we also have an advanced version of the software that allows to modify several system and sequence parameters, as well as setting up cues and reaction monitoring experiments.
Cool. And then there's a couple more, I think, best place for you, Wendy. What is the limit of detection or minimum concentration required?
So higher concentration, the better. But we generally recommend about 500 millimole for quick measurement times. With a 500 millimole sample, for example, you can obtain a proton spectra one scan in 10 seconds, and similar for fluorine. Lower concentrations, such as 50 millimole, it's possible, but you'll need much higher number of scans for increased signal-to-noise ratio.
And then just one more, Wendy, what is the gradient strength, just follow up from that previous one?
So our system comes with three field axis gradient built in. This is not an add-on. And as standard, our z-axis is 0.5 tesla per meter.
Awesome. Shieda, I'll bring you back in. What is the detection limit of time domain NMR?
The application, but we can also go to 0.05%. However, worth to mention that then maybe the measurement times takes a bit longer, because when you have low concentration, you need to apply more number of pulses, and it can go to up to 10 minutes or maybe 15 minutes if you have this low concentration sample.
Great. Raj, we've got a question for you here. I don't know if you're still on the line. You're having some connection issues, but hopefully
yep, I'm here.
Perfect. This question's asking, they would like to ask you to explain to them more how to do molecular composition by using NMR.
Yeah, that's a bit of a, I would say, almost an open-ended question, right? Like, just kind of depends on your sample, really. I mean, this is a pretty typical answer for any sort of NMR question, I would say, is like, it depends. but it really does. So for example, if you have like a really complex sample with a bunch of different molecules, you're probably going to be relying on some sort of database to pick out peaks that correspond to one particular molecule. It's going to be hard to do the exact structural characterization from scratch for unknown molecules that are present in your sample if it's a really complex mixture, right? If it's sort of a clean spectra, you've purified your product, then you know you can use, depending on the molecule, a bunch of different techniques to sort of elucidate the structure. You know, I went through an example with just very simple proton NMR, but of course there are like, you know, more complex techniques, more 2D NMR techniques, you know, your COSYs, HSQCs, HMBCs, all of these that sort of you can pull information from to figure out your composition. So it really just depends on your sample, but there's techniques that sort of allow you to pull more information for more complex molecules, even if you have a sort of a clean spectra. If not, then you know you might be sort of relying on databases or such.
Perfect. Raj, and I'll keep you on for this next one. I'm going to, this question is asking you to speculate a little bit, but they're asking, how do you see NMR after 5 or 10 years from now in terms of the applications?
I like that question. So this is speculation, but I think maybe something like the use of more AI in NMR to sort of detect the presence of known compounds, or maybe even predict the structure of unknown compounds from NMR spectra. I can see that being a big thing in the future. Maybe something like, say, you confiscate, say, like some white powder from the border, right? Like somebody's transporting some something suspicious. Then you could quickly use the NMR to figure out maybe what they have, even if it's a mixture of like various things, and you say AI to do it. But it is a bit of an open-ended question, and I do see a lot of different possibilities, but the one that I just mentioned, I'm particularly excited about.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll take a couple more. Raj, I don't know if you have any thoughts on this one. It might be better suited for Shieda, but it's asking, is it possible to measure sodium content in foods by NMR? If so, which Oxford instrument is most appropriate for this application?
To measure sodium content in food, we need the sodium probe. So at the moment, our MQC Plus can measure like hydrogen and fluorine. But our new products, maybe yes. But at the moment, not sodium.
Wonderful. One more for you, Shieda. Are there limitations to the type of samples that can be measured on the same fat content calibration?
In general, yes, we can use like just generate like a general calibration for different type of fat, like the same example that I showed in my presentation. So we just bought the product from the supermarket, then we made the calibration, and based on that calibration, we can use any samples. But because in fat application, we are measuring like proton intensity, and usually that's very similar for different oil and fat with different fatty acid composition. But of course, there are always some deviations. So usually it's good to check and see how your calibration is compatible for every sample.
There's another follow-up to that. They're asking, solid fat content by TD-NMR, is the sample heated internally or externally using water baths? Are autosamplers also an option?
Yes, usually based on the application, you need to condition your sample. You can do that like before measurement, like condition it like in the condition rack, like at different temperature. Also, our system is compatible with VT probe. It means you can measure from like 5 degrees or even less to 70 degrees Celsius. So you can also heat your sample during the measurement.
Wonderful. I think there's lots of unanswered questions, so we will get back to people via email if your question hasn't been answered today. But I think we'll just finish up with this one. And whoever thinks their best place to answer, just shout out. They're saying, hi, thank you for the presentation. Can this technique, method, instrument be used in mineral exploration?
Is that question from me?
That's an open question to anyone who wants to jump out and take it.
And can you please repeat it again?
Yeah, I'm just asking, can this technique, method, or instrument be used in mineral exploration?
That's a good question. So, maybe my colleagues can help Raj or Wendy. Otherwise, we can just think about and we can come back with the answer.
Yeah, that's one that I don't have an example off the top of my head, but yeah, so someone might have to come back to that one.
Yeah, so like I just said, any questions that haven't been answered, we'll pass them on to the three speakers today and they can follow up via email. But we will wrap things up there. So Raj, Wendy, Shieda, thank you very much for sharing your expertise with everyone today. Big thanks to everyone in the audience for joining us live. I hope you've enjoyed the content and I wish you all a pleasant rest of the day and hopefully see you all again very soon. Thank you very much.
Bye, everyone.